This is the Catch or Break podcast, the insider's guide to breaking into and navigating the entertainment industry. I'm Julie Harris Walker. You can find us at catchabreakpodcast.com and all the social media at Catch a Break Pod, as well as all the podcast places. The presenting sponsor of season 3 of Catch a Break is Revolution Entertainment Services, bringing digital accounting and payroll solutions to the production community. You can find them at www.revolutiones.com. Catch a Break is also sponsored by Cachet. Cachet is proud to introduce Cachet Pay, the no-touch, all-digital, pays-you-back AP system that you've been waiting for. And finally, we are also sponsored by Orlando's Motion Picture Catering, who has been feeding Hollywood since 2015. In this season, we are going to be talking with different groupings of crew members. We want to do a deep dive on all the different positions and understand how they all work together. For this episode, we're answering the question, where do the PAs and coordinators fit into all this? By talking with a key set PA, a production coordinator, and a post coordinator. Here we go. Let me introduce our guests. Giselle Vazquez is a freelance production assistant for television series and feature films. She most recently wrapped up working on Netflix Hentified and ABC's upcoming pilot Triage as the key production assistant. A visionary production assistant with a passion to share and create meaningful, visually compelling stories. Welcome, Giselle.
Thank you, Julie. Super excited to be here.
Brian Ayala was a post PA last year and has since been promoted to post coordinator. And he has a whole story about opening an ice cream shop that we're going to want to hear about. And his credits include Power and Power Book 2. Welcome, Brian.
Thank you for having me.
And finally, we have Weston Manville. Over the last several years, Weston Manville has risen up through the physical production ranks during his tenure at various studios and film productions in his native Los Angeles. Since graduating from the University of Oregon, he has worked as a studio page at CBS Television Studios, a production assistant on The Late Late Show with James Corden, the executive assistant to the senior EVP of production at CBS Television Studios, a coordinator of physical production at CBS Television Studios, manager of production under Jeanette Volturno at Blumhouse, and most recently, the production coordinator for 3 feature films under Catchlight Studios, including Songbird, which was the first film to be shot in Los Angeles following the industry-wide COVID-19 shutdown. We are going to want to hear all about that. He is an aspiring writer, producer who intends to produce his own content. Welcome, Weston.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Okay, now the first thing we like to do on the show is to ask everyone, what was your very first job in the business and how did you get it? Because we know everyone has a different path and we want to hear yours. So, Weston, what was your very first job and how did you get it?
My very first job, I was a PA on The Late Late Show with James Corden. The way I got that job was basically shotgunning informational interviews, meaning I went on as many as I could and, you know, just talking to people, not even necessarily looking for a job, just anyone in the industry that I could talk to. I'd try to set up a meeting with or figure out how to meet them. And eventually I met with someone at CBS. I think it was the head of HR there, Cassie Thomas. And she kind of pushed me in the direction for a brand new show that was in its first year, which was James Corden. And I got on. I got onto the staff there as a day player and then became an official PA, I think, for a little bit. So
the informational interview, that is great advice. We talk a lot about that, I think, in season 1 of Catch a Break, of how you really just got to ask everybody you can find to talk to you and tell you what they know.
Yeah. And I feel that people are flattered when you want to ask them about their life story sometimes. And if you're not really trying too hard to angle for, you know, give me a job, or, you know, you just say, hey, I'd like to hear about you or just talk to you, I feel like people are a little bit more open to that.
100%. How many carpool karaoke's did you do?
You know, I actually only went on one in like one of the follow cars where we would have to run out and get signatures of people that were in the background of camera. But it was always such a fun skit. But that really took off after I was there. So I was there during season 1 before those things really kind of took off, but it was cool.
That's the thing you don't think about. If someone is running behind getting signatures and releases off of people who just accidentally get in the background.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's funny. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Giselle, what was your first job and how did you get it?
My first job was an additional day player PA, set PA on Lethal Weapon. And I was brought in to do stunt day at 4 in the morning. Vasquez Canyon Rocks. And I kind of just got it purely out of luck. I was working at a radio station at the time, and I had a mutual connection with the Key Grip on Lethal Weapon, and they made the introduction, and yeah, I got on first day, and they kept asking me to come back, and season two, I was staffed and running first team.
That's a pretty good first job.
The stunts were fun. I love blowing up things.
Okay, Brian, what was your first job and how'd you get it?
I talk to everybody and anybody when I'm out. Like, I usually am always, I just like to talk to people. It doesn't necessarily have a motive behind it, but in passing, I meet people a lot and I have friends that I've met, and one friend connected me to another, and it ended up that I was actually looking for a place to stay, that I was looking for a place to like to room with someone, to find a roommate. And I guess my old roommate at the time was looking for someone because his roommate had just moved out. And so I ended up meeting with him, and we were kind of like, you know, oh, this works out. At the time, he was the post super for Modern Family. That's not why I moved in with him, but I moved in with him and, you know, we became really cool friends. And one of his friends that he worked with was like, hey, I have a job. Do you know anybody? And I was like, yeah, you want to recommend me? He recommended me, and I had been applying for a lot of places, but he recommended me over, and it worked out for all parties. And that's kind of how I started in Power.
Wait, the job was Power or the job was on Modern Family?
It was on Power. It was through mutual connections, though, through my roommate who had worked with the AP for Power previous and was roommates with him at one time, like years before. So it was just, you know, finding the connections through people that I had met.
This is a relationship business. We just hear that over and over and over again. Tell us really quick about how you took a sidebar and opened an ice cream shop in Scottsdale.
I was in LA. You know, I worked on a show for NBC, the affiliate. I was a PA for, God, what's the name of it? It was a food show. We used to go around to the different places, and I forget the name of the girl, but she would do travel and food. I can't remember the name. It's going to kill me. But the production got shut. Yeah, the production got shut down just because, I guess, funding and things like that. They stopped production early. They actually didn't pay us. And I ended up getting paid like 8 months later via a check because of a lawsuit, which was pretty crazy because I was already back in Phoenix at that point. But, you know, I worked in sales a long time, worked for, you know, GoDaddy, pretty big website company. I built websites and sold marketing packages to companies and made a lot of money, and decided to open up a ice cream shop because ice cream, you know, makes people happy. And I like making people, like, I like seeing people happy. I don't like mad people, which, you know, I don't like angry people. It's just not my thing. But I opened up an ice cream shop and did well. I had partners, and the partners didn't want to continue. We had some things happen, and we sold it, split, and went our separate ways. And I decided I was going to take another shot at LA. And here I am, back in the business. Fatty Daddies.
Yeah. I really just wanted to hear you say the name of the ice cream shop. I mean, is that the best?
It is.
Okay, Giselle, tell us about your current job, or the last job you had, because I realize you guys are freelance, going job to job to job. Tell us all about it, and what did your job entail, if you had to describe it to someone?
Yeah, so I just finished up 2 weeks on Hentified, and I was a key set PA. That was actually one of my favorite job positions. My day-to-day looked like following around the director and the cinematographer. And my end goal is to be a director, so getting, you know, the chance to just help them out and do all that stuff was super fun. So my day-to-day, though, consisted of, like, getting walkies prepped, making sure, you know, first AD director had food, making sure lockups were set. We had background. So, you know, making sure they were all COVID tested before we brought them onto set, and then, you know, bringing them onto set and getting them all placed. And yeah, essentially I was just helping out in any way, both with, you know, the personal needs, keeping everybody kind of happy and feeling supported, and, you know, like, they can have a water here and there. But at the same time, I also helped, you know, logistically placing background, you know, getting certain camera settings set up, and, you know, helping production save time when possible and that sort of thing.
Now, how much of your job is anticipating what people need? I'm sorry, Weston, were you going to say something?
I was going to say, after working with Giselle on one show, she's a very commanding presence on the walkie-talkie right over here. She's great at wrangling people. I just wanted to say that because she just reminded me of that as she was talking.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. You know, it is a team effort. So again, I work with, you know, tons of people, and I was able to do my job because of people like Weston that were on set as well as in the office kind of supporting me and all that good stuff. So yeah, it was fun.
Okay. So my question for you is, how much of your job is you anticipating what needs to happen versus other people higher up in the ranks telling you what to do? What's the balance there?
So essentially, I think my job is to anticipate every move. Like before the camera comes in, I want to kind of have an idea of like where we're going to see, what we're going to do and that sort of thing. But at the same time, going to the leaders and making sure that, you know, this is something that they want. At the end of the day, it's, you know, their vision. So my job is fully to anticipate everything, kind of be like, okay, camera's coming here. We're going to move all this. We'll bring background in at this time, this sort of thing. But at the same time, it's working with the first AD and the second on set to make sure that that's what they want, make sure that that's what's best for production need, what's going to be valuable for production. And at the same time, they appreciate that. Like, essentially, that's why I'm there, to kind of give them a plan to go off of. Usually they have notes, right? No, bring them in at this time, that sort of thing. But yeah, it's all about anticipating. I think a lot of the best way to get, you know, let the director kind of do what they need to do is be able to take away that, you know, logistics time, so they have more time to be creative with the performance. So 100% my job is just to anticipate every need, you know, even if they get thirsty, because, you know, if a director goes to the bathroom and you're waiting on them, or they have to do this, you know, you don't want to do that. So literally anticipation is my job.
It sounds like you need some real experience being a PA for a while before you could be that key set PA to have the wherewithal to be able to anticipate that stuff.
Yeah, I think like it's important to have experience, because I think there is this sort of hierarchy and a way of like running things that you learn, you know, with years of experience. But at the same time, I think just having a good sense of production and how to run a set like is also really helpful. Like, I've seen PAs that, you know, they don't have a ton of experience, but they have a lot of common sense, and they understand that like certain things, you know, take time. So I think just a lot of more production experience and like, yeah, I hate to say it, common sense too, you know, a little street smart always is good for this kind of stuff.
Yeah, common sense, not so common. It's important.
Yeah,
Weston,
exactly.
Tell us all about your job. What all does it entail?
Well, I would say I'm aware of many hats. There are some core essential duties that one can expect from a coordinator. I guess some of those things would be like the distribution of call sheets, working with the ADs to make sure those go out into the proper people, maintaining the crew list, which is a pain in the ass, but it's got to be done. So people really depend on that. Getting shooting schedules, one-liners, all those kinds of things from the ADs, and making sure they go out to everybody. Sometimes if they trust me, I can even look over them and just make sure little things are okay and all right on them. All the way down to like accounting, submitting POs, and pretty much also constantly answering questions from everybody on set and from all over, you know, agent assistants or wherever. It's really being an information hub, you know, talking to vendors and even, you know, more recently setting up testing or helping with that and getting that going. You know, we didn't really have testing coordinators or people like that until very, very recently. So it's a lot of learning on the job and figuring out how to put out new little fires all the time.
So when you say testing, you're talking about COVID testing.
Correct. Yeah. Yes. COVID testing.
So your job sounds more like an office job and Giselle's job sounds more like an on-set job. Is that right?
Yeah, I guess you could say that. I mean, I like to be running around as much as I can and see things on set. But I'd say, yeah, I could do my job pretty much anywhere. But at the same time, it's really nice to be around on set and see the people you're talking to and kind of just earning their trust and talking to them and just being one with the work. That sounds kind of corny, but I feel like it does help in the long run.
For sure. Brian, tell us all about your job. What all does it entail?
Well, now I'm kind of on like the opposite side of what Weston does. I mean, I'm, you know, as a production coordinator on the post side of things, I would call the, you know, production coordinator in the office and ask for script distros. And I would help with scheduling, you know, showrunners and EPs in the color reviews with our post producer, you know, just different things of scheduling, POs, but on the post side for VFX, things like that. You know, I distro cuts and I deal with the production side for corporate. Like for Stars, I deal with them and kind of help with requests that they have. I, you know, manage the post schedule. That's a big part of my job, which is basically just an entire calendar of, you know, when the cuts come out, when we're mixing, when we deliver, things like that. And then when I was a PA, which, you know, was more of it, was just really trying to support the person in my role now and the post producer and the AP and just kind of make sure that they don't have to focus on the small things because they have bigger things to do. So like stock footage, I would compile stock footage and help with distroing that, stuff like that.
Now, at what point in production do you come on?
You know, I can't say that I know for sure if this is the way every show does it, but we usually start 3 weeks to a month before shooting starts.
So you're there the whole time.
Yeah. And then we're there after.
Yeah, you're there till it's over.
Yeah, exactly.
You talked a little bit about how you would work with Weston. I'd love to hear more about how you would all work with each other or different departments, because no one is an island just doing their one little siloed thing.
Yeah, it's totally not. Well, like, so right now I'm scheduling a lot of ADR just because we're in that, you know, stage where we have to pick up lines or things like that. And
can you explain that for people who don't know what ADR is?
It basically on set, there's a few different reasons ADR would happen. If somebody says something and it's not correct dialect, if they say a word and we can't hear it or it's not pronounced properly, sometimes the person's clothing will muffle a word or a whole sentence. We re-record it with the actor and then place it over in mix. We actually will, you know, mimic the line and then place it over. Or if they're turned around and you don't see the person's mouth and we want them to say something they didn't actually say, we'll add that as well.
Okay, so go on. You were saying about how you would all work together.
Yeah, so like right now, I'm having to schedule 10 to 15 people for every episode every other week and loop group, handling loop group, who does all the background talking and chatter for shows. And, you know, it can be difficult because you have, you know, actors that are shooting and you have to make sure that their schedule allows. And sometimes their managers and that aren't the easiest to deal with or get a hold of, really. It's not that they're hard to deal with, but they're hard to get a hold of because you'll send them an email, you'll call them and they won't return your call for 3 or 4 days. And sometimes you need to have an answer like in an hour because they're like, we need this done before we lock in 3 days. And you're like, okay. So, you know, you go to the first AD or you go to the production coordinator and you say, hey, I need to get a hold of so-and-so for ADR. Can you help me? And another big reason that I deal with the production coordinator a lot is because we're in two different states. Post-production is in LA and we shoot in New York. So it's not like I can go on set and talk to the AD right now. Whereas if we were, then I would just be able to go there.
Right. Great. Weston, how about you?
Well, again, basically everything he said is correct. A lot of those situations arise. I also am just thinking about the last time I talked to one of our post coordinators or supervisors is when we need to set up a runner to physically take the footage from that day to a post house. And so just kind of setting those things up and just making sure everyone gets what they need, making sure all the camera and sound reports go out properly. And these are all things that the editorial team needs. So there is a lot of thinking ahead about what posts we'll need. And I'm usually working with either the post coordinator or the supervisor about how to help make that process complete. And with Giselle, if we're talking about all three of us, how we work, like, again, always just hearing her on the radio kind of control set. And a lot of the times, you know, when Giselle would need something, you know, she would just radio down to me and I'd, you know, either send a PA up to her or help her out with whatever she needed. And, you know, I was just there to support her as she's there to support the team. So
Giselle.
He would send me care packages. He's no dum-dum.
Eagle is
lying. Yeah. He kept me and the actors very happy. And kind of going off of what Brian and Weston were saying, I've also had it where my job is kind of being the person that takes the actor to ADR. So you have a post person coordinating, you know, with the production coordinator. Then the production coordinator is texting me and is like, okay, when it's, you know, 20 minutes to spare, take the actor to ADR and get that done. Because if we don't have it by tonight, you know what I mean? So it's like, it's really cool. But yeah, a lot of it, you see our positions are kind of, you know, it makes a circle go around kind of thing.
So many moving parts and it's all so interconnected.
Yeah.
What is something about your job that you did not anticipate getting into this business? Like, what's something that happened or something you learned where you're like, wow, didn't see that coming. That was not something I expected.
You know, one of the things that I remember, obviously had been, you know, 10 years since I had even touched the industry. But even back then, it didn't seem as much of a thing. But, that you know, they tell you it's long days. Right. And you think about that and you're like, yeah, it's a long day. But it really, like, I think that's one thing I totally forgot in getting back into it. It really is a lot of work and a long day. Like, I'm usually up at 7 and I'm working until 10, 11, 12 at night sometimes. And it's like, it doesn't stop, especially considering that, you know, you have the shows on 2 different time zones. It makes it that much more difficult because at 7, it's 10 o'clock on the East Coast.
You're already late.
Right. So you already have to catch up for the day. And then by the time you've caught up, you know, it's 4 or 5. Everybody's done on the East Coast, but post-production's still going on the West Coast. So I think that's one of the things that I really was like, wow, you know, the days can get really long.
Except I bet it's really stimulating and engaging and kind of fun.
Yeah, it's super fun. It still is a lot of fun.
Weston, how about you? What was surprising about this business?
Again, as Brian said, the time you put into these productions was a lot different than what I was used to coming from the studio side, which was more of a 9-to-5 kind of. So that and the organized chaos that it takes to be okay with on a production. I was always a bit of a perfectionist and took things very personally when they weren't done exactly right. And with productions, you don't really have the luxury to take that amount of time to go over so many things. I mean, things like a crew list, yes, they have to be 100% right all the time. But, you know, if somebody in the camera department, you know, orders a camera package and there's one thing wrong on it that they really needed, you can't just sit there and argue with them and be like, you did the wrong thing. You just got to fix it, go to the vendor, get something else and move on and go forward and, you know, roll with the punches, so to speak. So there's a lot of thinking on your feet, a lot of just going with the flow for lack of better words that, you know, I've had to really learn and get comfortable with, which is great.
It's so funny because I think that the personality type in production is such a driven type A personality that the go with the flow part is probably like really hard unless you can just incorporate that into your forward driving, pushing personality.
Yeah, I compartmentalize a lot.
Yeah. I bet at the end of the day that when you lie down and start processing the whole day, that must be a whole nother process to unwind and go to sleep.
Absolutely.
Giselle, how about you? What was surprising?
Yeah, the long hours. And then just as well as the long hours working under a lot of just time restrictions, you know, you have certain amount of time to get a lot of crazy stuff done, you know? And also just the business kind of takes a toll on you physically, you know, on top of the long hours. I think like I didn't realize how much I have to actually take care of my body and like actually eat right here and there. And, you know, even though Crafty has all this stuff, like you have to make sure you're eating your greens and stuff like that, because before you know it, you know, you do feel it physically. So I definitely wasn't expecting to take so much of that into consideration for work. You know what I mean?
That is such a good point and such good advice. Otherwise you will burn out. You'll, you know, be 30 and be done because your body breaks. You really have to take care of yourself. Mm-hmm. What's the craziest thing you've ever been asked to come up with on a production?
I have one thing in particular that always jumps out my mind. It was on my first job as a PA on the Late Late Show with James Corden. And they did this game. I forget exactly what it was or how to describe it, but essentially you'd spin a thing and whatever it lands on, the person who spun it would get that prize. And one of the prizes was a frozen pizza. But that's the thing with this game. There was always like a trick or something different about that prize. So you would think it was just like a DiGiorno frozen pizza, but they had me take a piece of pizza and figure out how to freeze it in a block of ice. And so I essentially just found a piece of pizza, saran wrapped it really tightly, submerged it in water and froze it overnight in like three different ways. I had to figure out that boiled water actually freezes clear and unboiled water doesn't. I mean, that was just kind of a weird, fun thing. And I was like, you know what? I kind of like being in this industry. But, you know, my job tasks have evolved since then. But that was kind of one of the craziest, funniest things to do.
That's funny. How about you, Giselle?
I think it was one night when we were shooting in Malibu around 8, 9 p.m. One of the directors comes up to me and says he wants to do something nice for the crew and bring in like a whole like just plate of food from this restaurant that's like 10 minutes from closing. And I was like, okay. And we made it happen. And we did the call and we ended up getting the food within like 30 minutes. And everybody was really happy. But I really was like, wow, being tested. I had a sweet talk to the restaurant.
Like, has it changed your perspective on what is actually possible in the world?
Oh, totally. Totally. That's what I was telling one of my friends. Is like, I don't scare easily anymore. It's very hard possible to scare me.
Brian, how about you?
I mean, yeah, that's kind of the thing, right? Is you like Giselle said, you learn to not scare easily because you'll get things that are asked of you and you just have to figure out a way to do it. And I mean, I think being asked sometime to do things and you're just like, oh man, how am I going to get this done? And you're just kind of like, I don't know. Like we've had, you know, shotgun mixes where it's just like a mix is going to happen. We've moved a mix and you know what, instead of mixing in 4 days, we're mixing tomorrow and we got to figure this out because normally with mix, you know, you have people from the, whoever's putting it on Lionsgate or Stars and you have your EPs and all these people are going to meet and they're going to go over to do a review. And we usually do like breakfast or things like that for it. And if it's, you know, 4 or 5 days out, you have enough time to plan it. But if it's not, well, guess what? Now you and the PA, well, as a PA, you know, I did this, like the PA is scrambling because they have to figure out, okay, how am I going to make this spread happen and make sure all of their stuff is in the building so that they can start 4 days earlier than they were supposed to. And I mean, sometimes it's kind of like you just kind of go with the flow and hope that it all lands. And it usually does. Sometimes it doesn't, but you know, you deal with that when you can.
Now, I sense that, or you've explicitly said that your career, you're on your way to something else, right? So I'd love to hear what is your ultimate goal and how is your current job helping you get there? Who's ready to start with that one? Okay, Weston, go.
So it's kind of interesting. Like Brian had said earlier about making people happy, one of my goals, or I guess my ultimate goal, is to make people laugh. So I also do comedy writing on the side, or just kind of all kinds of writing, actually. And the way I have always kind of looked at this career path is a funny analogy I use, or story I use, is like, if you want to run a Subway or own a Subway, you got to learn how to make the sandwiches. So being a production coordinator and trying to move my way up is me learning how to make the sandwiches. I would love to just know as much as I can, every single facet, how everyone works together, how to do things cheaply, like where you can take away from one place and give to another, all those types of things, so that if I'm ever in the position where I am actually, you know, show running a show or producing a show or something that I love and hold dear to myself, I don't have to really be at the whim of everyone else telling me how to do these things. And I can kind of, you know, steer the ship in the right direction and just not freak out if things go wrong. So it kind of keeps me running at the end of the day, just knowing that, you know, although I, you know, don't like doing crew lists at 2 a.m., I know that there's a larger picture here and I'm working towards it and just becoming really familiar with everything.
That's going to make you a really good showrunner at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. And I've talked to a few people, you know, we're just, you know, shooting the shit around set, like, and they're all like, we love our showrunners, our producers, our people that actually came up through the set. It's a huge difference talking to someone who understands that things can't be done in 10 minutes than, you know, some studio exec that, you know, will ask of impossible things or question you for things that, you know, if you were just around on set, you would understand better.
That's great. Brian, did you want to jump in on that?
I was just going to say, like, 99.9% of the rest of the people in LA that started their path, that, you know, everybody is a writer. I'm a writer. I'm not a great writer, but I'm learning to write. I want to be a showrunner. I have ideas that, you know, from my neighborhood, my background. Hentified is actually a show I really enjoy, and it's on the comedy spectrum. I want to do something on the drama spectrum, but, you know, in regards to the Latino community and things like that. And like, my vision was always to be a showrunner, but, you know, you obviously can't, it's very hard to become a showrunner. Even if you work your way up, it's like, you know, a 5% chance. So not working your way up, it's a 1% chance. So I know that, you know, working in the industry and making the valuable connections and continuing to hone my craft and figure it out is really the only way to get to that point. And like Weston said, you know, knowing how the sausage is made for the sandwich helps you make the right sandwich and make the right things happen. And I think that's a big part of it. I totally agree with him.
Great. Giselle, you said you wanted to be a director. How is this helping you?
I mean, being on set and getting to learn how it's run, you know, quite honestly, I went into being a PA because I couldn't afford film school, you know, so the best way to learn how to direct for me was to go on set, look at what these directors do, and also put, you know, my foot in the door as well, like get my hands on and, you know, be involved as best as I can. And truthfully, it was the best path for me because similar to like these guys, you need to learn how to cook before you finish up the sandwich and all that stuff. I think I totally messed that up. But it was important for me to also like see it from the ground up, what it means to like have nothing and then really come in and put this production together. And then again, tell these really impactful stories. A part of why I want to be a director is, again, I really want to tell these Latina driven stories, especially being a female Mexican American, you know, I think we're lacking of that. So I want to be able to be an ally for these stories if I'm not directing them. And I think being a PA is the best way to not just learn and grow, but also be involved in that.
If I could too, one thing I want to add to that too, like she's right. I don't have any formal training. I don't have a college education even. So I didn't go to film school. I've learned everything I've learned out of passion, not out of going to school or paying for the degree or anything like that. And I'm not knocking those people because those people are, I have a lot of friends that came from the film industry that are super intelligent and they were able to move up fast. And, you know, I've had a lot more struggles in it, but at the same point, I think a lot of people get discouraged because they're like, oh, I really want to be a writer, but I don't have the formal training and I don't have and you don't need it. If you really want something, you just have to go after it. And I think a lot of people forget that, mm-hmm. especially because this industry itself is so competitive because there's so many people that can do the job and that will do the job. So it's kind of like that next in line. If you know, it's constantly evolving and constantly moving forward. So I think that's, you know, that's a big part of it too.
I agree with you, Brian, very much so. Like if you want to be a writer, you can be a writer. I mean, just sit down and write. You can have your job and then write on the weekends. And I always think it's funny when I see something on TV and I'm like, wow, that really sucks. Like, I can do better than that. So I'm like, all right, then do it. So I just, you know, it's cool. But yeah, to your point, like, you don't have to be hired as a writer to be a writer. Anyone can do it. You just got to do it.
I think a lot of people are afraid to start at the bottom mm-hmm. too. I mean, I was, you know, 10 years later, I was 32 years old, or I'm sorry, I was 30 years old starting back up, and I was a PA at 30, and people, you know, I got told, oh, you're too old to be a PA. It's like, why am I too old?
Yeah.
Who says that I can't do the same things? Because I'm 30, I have a different, you know, outlook on it. If anything, I have more experience under me. And I think a lot of people, I have friends that our writers are fantastic writers, and they don't want to become a writer's PA because they feel like it's beneath them in their age. And it's like, if you really want it, you're going to get it any way you can. And that means starting at the bottom. You'll start at the bottom.
And also get in the room.
Yep. Like, that's half the battle is just, yeah, getting your foot in the door and, you know, making those connections and meeting people. Like, yeah, being a PA should never be beneath you.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds cliche, but it's just, you know, meeting those connections, our timing is everything. So you never know. And whatever position you're in, if you're at least in the door and around the right person, then a chance could happen.
Giselle's dying to get in.
Well, I was just going to say, ironically, like, especially right now with COVID, it's almost like being a PA is your best option because that's the only way you're going to get on set. You know what I mean? The shadowing programs don't exist at the moment. All these other programs that, you know, you could get on set don't exist at the moment. The only way you could really do it is if you're actually, you know, an assistant working on set or, you know, whatever that may be, but actually with the show. And like, I've seen a lot of like COVID monitors too, where they're like hustling to try to get into the industry. And because they're monitors, now they actually have a career in the industry. They actually got like staffed as a set PA and that sort of thing. So I think it's kind of silly when people look beneath any job because, yeah, going off of what Brian and Weston are saying, if you want to do it, you're going to do it. You're going to get there. You just got to work hard, you know?
Yeah, it's really hard to wait and then come in at the top. That's a hard journey.
Yeah.
So speaking of which, and we did a whole episode about this on season one, about as you're starting out and it's freelance, how do you manage the finances of it all so that you can sustain yourself to stay in it until you get to that point where you don't have to worry so much about it? How do you set yourself up to do that? Brian?
That's another thing, right? Is you get paid nothing at the bottom. Unfortunately, you know, none of the money goes to the bottom few. And one thing to remember, like that's another thing, right? Is you learn that you have to cut corners. You have to live with roommates. You have to, you know, not go out all the time and devote your money to places that are going to pay your bills and not have a nice car. And I think that a lot of people don't want to live uncomfortably, so they're more afraid to take those leaps. And I think that's a big part of it, right? Not everybody is fortunate enough to have someone that can back them. And I think remembering that, you know, it's not going to be all sunshine and rainbows financially. Like I lived on a couch for a year and didn't have, and I had a car that had 300,000 miles on it and barely got me where I was going as a PA. Like you have to, your car is your only thing that matters as a PA. And I remember going out on runs and thinking, man, I really hope my car doesn't break down. And it's just like, you know, you just kind of have to do it.
Yeah. Exactly. Weston or Giselle?
My general rule in life is to just spend wisely. So I'm always doing that anyway. But I think another way to not stress about it so hard is just continue making relationships with as many people as you can. I personally have been blessed to, you know, be working with Jeanette and a handful of other producers through the whole old Blumhouse world and now the Catchlight world. And they've been very good about putting me on jobs or just supporting, you know, me in whatever way they can. And, you know, again, just meeting as many people as you can is a great way to ensure that there will always be an opportunity for you to have a job or to, you know, go on an informational interview and figure out if you want another job and et cetera, et cetera.
Giselle, what's your wisdom on this?
Okay. So yeah, I'm not even going to front. I'm not going to lie. I'm really lucky that I have a huge support system from my family. So a lot of it comes from, you know, if I have to do a job that might not pay everything, like luckily I have them for support. But I also do what Weston and Brian also do, just sticking around with the right people. And sometimes you gotta, you know, understand if you're not making that paycheck that you want to make, you have to remember that in the long run, it's going to be worth it. And sometimes, you know, not being able to go out to eat one weekend is just going to have to be the reality of it. And yeah, just being smart about it too, especially if like you're trying to shoot your own projects, making sure that you're also, you know, saving up for that as well. And just having that balance of what you need. And then as well as I think your investments, you know, especially in this career or in this industry, I think you should always be working on your side projects.
Yeah, it's a long game for sure.
Yeah.
Okay, so this brings us to our martini shot, which you guys will know is the last shot of the day. So I'm going to ask you a final question, and that's going to be either what do you think is the most important part of your job, or what is the most important part of someone else's job that helps you do what you do?
As important as my job is, I feel like the team that I work with is just as important. And it's kind of one of those things that I've come to learn that no specific part of my job is the most important part of my job. And sometimes is, you know, it's basically, I think the most important thing in my job is being a team player and knowing that sometimes you're going to have to wear multiple hats and jump in when somebody below you or above you needs you to jump in and take control or help with something, and vice versa, right? Like there's times that even as a coordinator, right, you become a coordinator from being a PA and you're like, God, I never want to do that again. And you have to take those steps back and help out, because if your PA is successful, then you're going to move up and they're going to move up. If your boss is successful, they get to move up and you get to move up. So I think the most important part of my job is understanding that it's my job is as much their job as their job is my job, if that makes sense.
It does. Weston.
A wise woman once told me that in order to really do a physical production job effectively at, you know, either like a coordinator or manager level, is you have to kind of wear your flak jacket and be a therapist to pretty much anybody and everybody. So aside from obviously all my daily duties and things that are expected, I think a really cool and important part of my job that I've really grown to like is just to listen to people and take the temperature of everyone in the room and kind of just figure out like how to make the team work together and be the glue that helps everyone stick together. So you could say like, on one page are my duties and responsibilities, but I feel like I've been pretty good about growing them and getting trusted with more and new kind of responsibilities. And a lot of that has come, I think, from just listening to people and growing and being able to do new things. And yeah, I think I'm pretty happy with that answer.
Was that wise woman Jeanette Volturno?
Sure was. That obvious?
That sounds like her.
Absolutely.
Giselle, what is your martini shot?
I love what Brian said about being a team player. You know what I mean? I think just being able to not just keeping your team happy and making sure they feel supported, but also making sure you get the project done. You know what I mean? Like for me, that's really important, even as a PA, making sure that like you're able to step away and feel like you did your job right. And you also, you know, were a part of just a great story and everybody was support, you know, felt supported and able to do their thing. And yeah.
This is so great. Thank you all so much for joining us on Catch a Break. Weston Manville, Giselle Vazquez, and Brian Ayala. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. And nice to meet you and Weston and Giselle as well.
Yeah, this was fun. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Julie, for having me. It was so great chatting with you, Weston and Brian.
We hope you enjoyed this episode of Catch a Break. We'd like to thank our guests, Giselle Vazquez, Weston Manville, and Brian Ayala. And special thanks to Alternative Rentals for their support. Alternative Rentals is a premier cinema camera house that supplies digital camera equipment to high-profile scripted TV shows, feature films, and commercials across the nation. With offices both in Los Angeles and Atlanta, Alternative Rentals is committed to providing their clients a five-star experience in all budget ranges. And also special thanks to Kruvy, reinventing the playing field in entertainment worldwide. Find them at Kruvy, Kruvie.com. Please check out our website at catchabreakpodcast.com and follow us on all the social media. Catch a Break is produced in partnership with Cashlight Films, Rose Colored Pictures, and The Other 50%, and is edited by Lasta Drakovich. Our theme music, Mantra for a Struggling Artist, was composed by Andrew Jocelyn. Thanks for listening, and be sure to check out our next episode where we talk about fixing it in post with a post supervisor, editor, and a visual effects supervisor.